is Thursday, August 22nd. This is the Christian Commute. I am your host, Seth Dunn. And my sticky note just fell. Thanks a lot, Cameco. I'm trying to get out of CPE. Atlanta traffic is horrible. It says it's going to take me an hour to go 35 miles. So today I'm going to try and find the express lane that I could not find before. I thought about staying for the Braves game. I'm actually looking at Truist Park right now. The Braves play the Phillies at 7. But I don't want to wait here for another, 2.5 hours for the game to start. I got up early today, so I'm sleepy. So I'm just going to drive home, watch the Braves on TV. Now, yesterday I made a mistake. I made a big mistake that I didn't have to pay for because I missed the express lane, but traffic wasn't bad. Today traffic's bad, so I got to figure out how to get to the express lane. So I'm going to pause the show until I get there. I made it to the express lane. So I had to go backwards from where I was to get on 75 a little further up the road, because if you get off of Cobb Parkway right onto 75, you somehow miss the entrance to the express lane. And I don't think the computer understood that even though it took me a couple minutes more, maybe 5 minutes more, to track backwards to get on here, that I'm going to save it by not getting on 75. Computer says this is how long it takes now. I don't think the computer knows that some idiot on I-75 is going to rear end somebody else while he's looking on the phone, because it happens every day. And that's in the Ted Cruz voice. Every day it happens. I can't do an impression of Ted Cruz. But he's on Twitter. He cusses. I'm not going to say it. Every D-Day. This is a PG podcast. I guess it's rated G, because in PG you can say cuss words. All right. This is going to cost me $6.85, and I'm gladly going to pay it. I'm going to pay it happily. When you get your money's worth, you're happy to pay. And thanks to Ben. Was that guy's name Ben? We have a full show. I was sitting in CPE. I was about to leave. I checked my email, and somebody sent in a question. So I've got a question about Anabaptists. It would not have been a full show without it. So I've got that. Today's show title is Christian Media and the Money Men. That Shepherds for Sale, Christian Media and the Money Men. We're on chapter 4, and I'm reminded I need to take that book and give it to my friend who I told that I'd loan it to her. So I get to that when I get to that. I left it at home. So as I speed away from where I could have watched the Atlanta Braves, the accountant in me wanted to stay because parking is $35, and I got in at 10 because this morning I'm like, I'm saving $25 on parking. I buy a $9 ticket. I'm in there because I don't have to take any kids. It's just me. I can see the Braves for $40. It's a deal. I wanted to get it, but you know what? I'm going to watch it at home on my couch. Listen, married people, I would have paid for that. I would have paid for leaving and not coming home and going to watch the Braves without anybody in my family. My wife would have made me pay. Not with money, but in some other way. You married people know what I'm talking about, especially you men. Especially you women, you know what you do. All right. Let's get into the Bible. Nobody listens to this to hear my opinions on marriage, even though I think they're pretty good. I could probably make a lot of money being one of these Dr. Phil, Dr. Laura podcasters. You know what your problem is, and you can put this in your pipe and smoke it and take it to the bank. How's that working out for you? Do it my way. That's the paradigm you're operating on, and you need to put that dime in the payphone and call somebody to come take it away. Dr. Phil ever disappears, I'm right here. Okay. Luke chapter 3, verses 32 through 38. This is going to close out This is going to close out Luke chapter 3 like Rafael Iglesias closing out the Phillies. Luke chapter 3 verses 32 through 38. We're going to finish the genealogy, and then Luke 4 moves into his temptation in the wilderness. So as soon as Jesus started his public ministry, the devil came after him. We'll get to that when we get to that. So we left off in his genealogy at his ancestor David. And as I mentioned yesterday, David was the son of Jesse, who was the son of Obed, who was the son of Boaz, who is one of the figures in the book of Ruth. I try not to say characters because these people are real. They're not book characters like Harry Potter is a character in a book, or The Great Gatsby is a character in a book. These are real people, not just characters. Oh my goodness, it's even slow in the luxury lane. Speed up! What's going on? We got a bottleneck. It's the same people that get in front of me in the coffee line. We had a coffee buffet. Guys, how many, you get behind these people in the coffee line at church? They get there, they stand on the coffee, they put their coffee into the cup, then they keep standing in front of the coffee to put their cream and sugar in. Like, no, move away from the coffee thing. Get your cream and sugar, move away from the cream and sugar thing, and then prepare your coffee while everybody else goes through the line. These are the same rubberneckers who get to a turn in the road. Well, I don't know what to do. I'm going to look over here. And they're in the luxury lane, taking the value away from my $6.85. David, son of Jesse, son of Obed, son of Boaz, son of Salmon, son of Nahshon, son of Amminadab, son of Ram, son of Hezron, son of Perez, son of Judah. All right, we're talking tribe of Judah. And if my Sunday school learning doesn't fail me, it wasn't Perez, Judah's son, where that woman tricked him into getting her pregnant Judah's sons were supposed to marry one of his son's widows, but they didn't want to. So Tamar tricked Judah into sleeping with her, and I think that Perez was the result of that. So Jesus has some prostitution in his background, because Rahab's on the list too. And Rahab, Tamar wasn't a prostitute for a living. Rahab was. Tamar just had to use that profession to trick Judah. And Rahab, as is the case with Ruth, we're talking about Gentiles. All right? Where was I before I started talking about all the prostitutes in Jesus' lineage? Judah, son of Jacob, son of Isaac, son of Abraham. All right? That's it. Everybody after Abraham's a Jew. All right? Chosen people of God, the promise of God to bless the world through his line. So that's where the Abrahamic line starts. So now we get into, I'll say, the rest of us genetically. Abraham, son of Terah, son of Nahor, son of Sarag, son of Reu, son of Peleg, son of Heber, son of Shelah, Shug of Canaan, son of Arphaxad, I don't think I wrote that right, son of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. We started about table of nations here. Everybody is a descendant of either Shem, Ham, or Japheth. And then Noah. This is all our common ancestry. All right? We're all from Noah. We're not all from Abraham. We're not all from Shem, Ham, or Japheth, but now we're all from Noah, because we're tracking back. And remember, Gentiles are going to be reading this. So we get all the Jewish lineage. Now we're getting back into everybody's lineage. Okay? Noah, son of Lamech, son of Methuselah, son of Enoch, son of Jared, son of Mahalalel, son of Canaan, son of Enosh, son of Seth. By the way, I'm named after him. I don't know if I'm named after him. My mom just liked the meaning of the name. Son of Adam. And who is Adam? The son of God. Adam was the first person God ever made, and we all come from him. So Luke tracks Jesus' lineage back through the royal Davidic line, then all the way back to Abraham, then all the way back to Noah, then all the way back to Adam. All right, because Jesus, by the way, and there's a message here that we should understand. Jesus is Savior for us all. He's the second Adam. Yes, He is the Messiah in the line of David. Yes, He's the Lion of Judah, but He's also the second Adam, the Savior of us all of mankind. All right, now let's move on to the question. Was it Dan? Was this guy's name Dan or Ben? I had to put my phone down because I'm driving. I didn't write it down. I made my show note early in the day. I was like, oh, I don't have a question in the inbox. I'm going to have to give an anecdote. I'm going to have to ask people to send me money about the Y Project. And I have a great anecdote about something that happened to me today in the Y Project land. This is where it, you know, flesh meets flesh, handshake type stuff. This is where the rubber meets the road, if you will. Not just a website, but talking to a person in person and affecting their life about this in a positive way. Two things happened to me today on that. But I'm not going to tell it. And then I'll tell it on, what day is it? I'll tell it tomorrow if I don't get a question. Is tell it a Southernism? Like, go tell it on the mountain. Is it recount the story, say it? I don't know. The people from other parts of the country say tell it. I'm going to tell it tomorrow. Like we say tote it instead of carry it. We say tell it. Somebody said that I was country today, or so, somebody I was talking to, one of the salesmen at this conference, was like, do I detect an accent, a Southern accent? Like, yeah, you do. Of course you do. We're in Atlanta. We all got one. But I guess I was especially Southern. Some of y'all may think that. Today's question, what did I say this guy's last name? Dan, Ben, sorry, I'm horrible with names especially. Thanks for writing in, by the way. I very much appreciate it. You really came through. I don't think this guy's ever written in before. Dog spread love, not COVID-19. To learn more, visit American Humane. You know, that money could have fed somebody. I saw somebody on Facebook today say her dog was in heaven because he had a soul. I'm sorry, does your dog know Jesus is his Lord and Savior? The things people say. This question came in on the inbox. If you have a question about Christian theology and apologetics, you can write to SethDunn88@gmail.com. SethDunn88@gmail.com or dial 470-315-0875. The Christian Commute is your theological roadside assistance. And here's the question. What's the difference between a Baptist and an Anabaptist? I'll throw one in there. Which one came first? I'll let y'all argue about that all over the trail of blood. So, we'll put it this way. I don't even know if I can put it that way. I wanted to say all Baptists are Anabaptists, but not all Anabaptists are Baptists, but that doesn't make any sense. I think it's all Anabaptists are Baptists, but not all Baptists are Anabaptists might make more sense. So the name Anabaptist is a pejorative, and it came out of what we can call the Radical Reformation. So there's the Reformation, then there's the Radical Reformation. So Martin Luther starts moving people around from Rome, and then people start reading the Bible more, and what happens? Everybody gets their own wild ideas. And everybody says, I'm going to make new churches and do stuff, so you get the Radical Reformation. An Anabaptist would tell you he is not from the Reformation. He'd say the Reformed people came from Catholics, and we didn't do that. We're totally separate. That's what the Anabaptist would tell you. But it's a pejorative, Anabaptist, because it means baptized again. Like rebaptizer. In the original language. I think it's German or something. But out of Europe, out of the Radical Reformation, people figured out, hey, wait a minute. Not only is the Catholic Church bogus, these guys thought, we got to make some rules or we'll just be bogus too. All right, thank you, Spicoli. But not only did they figure out the Catholic Church was bogus, but they started figuring out what? They started figuring out that, oh no, I'm about to get off the wrong exit. Let me over. that infant baptism was bogus too. So they started baptizing professed believers, as is the biblical way. And this struck people the wrong way, whether they were Catholic or Protestant, because they said, no, these people are already baptized, because they thought infants being baptized was a thing, so they pejoratively called them rebaptizers or Anabaptists. That's where the name came from. Now, when you look at Baptists, well, we have the same view of baptism they do, so at that time they may have called us, we Baptists, Anabaptists too. So in the history of the Reformation and Baptists, Anabaptists and Baptists are kind of wrapped up, and we Baptists will say, no, this was the New Testament way. It's always been this way. We didn't come out of the Reformation. I'm a Baptist. I'm like, yeah, I recognize that there's a strain that came out of the Reformation. Sorry, I can't go back to the trail of blood. I'd like to think somewhere, some way, somebody was always baptizing, right? But I'm not going to get into all that. Oh, my luxury lane's about to run out. I made good time in it. $6.85. But here's the difference, okay? And we're talking about tendencies here, because there's a blue million different kind of Baptists and a blue million different kind of Anabaptists. That's what happens when you get a congregational polity. You have all these different congregations, and they make all their different conventions and different kinds of colors and shapes and numbers. And there's just so many kinds of Baptists. I have a book at my house called The 12 Tribes of Baptists in America. And the author tries to classify the different types of Baptists into 12 tribes, and there's even subgroups of them. It's crazy. There's so many different types of Baptists. But Anabaptists would tend to be radical separationists. They would view participating in civil government as worldly, so they don't do it. You won't find them running for office, either now or even back then, because they're practicing, they'd call it holiness, but anthropologists or history people would just say it's radical separation. And think of Hutterites, Mennonites, and Amish people. They live in their own communities. Anabaptists are often more communal than the rest of us. They live in their own communities or communes. They have a unique way of dress. In the case of the Amish, they don't use modern technology if they can get away with not using it. The women have a head covering. They're pacifists. I mean, that's not always been true in history, but for the most part, Anabaptists have been pacifists. Because why? Because getting involved in a war would be to get involved in the civil, worldly powers who are fighting the wars, and they want that separation. Now, theologically, Anabaptists have more in common with general Baptists, but you also have the idea of regular Baptists, which are more Calvinistic Baptists. So a difference between at least historical Baptists, I'm not talking about Baptists as we are now, because by the way, hey guys, theology's out the window, soteriology's out the window. It's all about nickels and noses in Baptist world now. Nobody cares about soteriology, apparently, anymore. Yeah, you know, like when's the last time you heard Rick Patrick talk about theology? What is this in front of me? Hold on. Guess what's in front of me? It is a sticker. It is a sticker for Cross Point City Church. You got to be kidding me. Go to ycrosspoint.com. Please, is that a Nissan Rogue? I like those cars. Nissan Rogue, go to CrossPoint, ycrosspoint.com. I was distracted. Oh yeah, Anabaptists tend to be more Arminian in their theology. Not in the sense of losing your salvation, but in the sense of free will in your salvation. A more general Baptist thought than the more Calvinistic or predestinarian regular Baptists. But the main difference is a Baptist would run for political office, vote, serve in the army, not make his wife dress like an Amish person, not tend to live in a commune, and by chance would be more Calvinistic than an Anabaptist, who are radical separationists and pacifists and have a more Arminian idea of soteriology. The sameness between the two is, of course, they baptize. And if you want to think of a scholar, a contemporary Baptist scholar who's big into Anabaptist history and maybe even views himself as a kind of an Anabaptist, but he's not like a Mennonite or anything like that, Emir Kaner, who's the president of Truett-McConnell College. That's Ergun Kaner's brother. So Ergun Kaner's the charlatan. Ergun Kaner is the wicked, phony charlatan. Emir is, at best, an enabler of Ergun over the years, but he kept his job and dodged all that scandal from Ergun. He's a big deal in Georgia Baptist land. You want to talk about who's not Calvinistic? Georgia Baptist land. So Anabaptists are going to have a, or at least that type of soteriology is going to, the Georgia Baptist Convention or Georgia Baptist Mission Board is going to be more sympathetic to that. So if you want to know more about Anabaptists from somebody who's writing about them and studying them currently, Emir Kaner knows about that. All right, now I got them. I'm out of the luxury lane. That was worth every bit of my $6.85, every bit of it. And now, what am I? If this was a Freemason in front of me, I would follow him home. I would find his address, and I would mail him a copy of my Freemasonry book. And I might do the same if it was a Jesus Calling person. I'd mail them a copy of another Jesus Calling, even though I didn't write that. It's just a good book. If it was an Elevation or Andy Stanley person, I might do it. I might do it. But since it's a Crosspoint person, unlike a Freemason, they are the same religion as me. Like, a Crosspoint's statement of faith is perfectly orthodox. I have no reason to believe that the people who make professions of faith there aren't really getting saved. I mean, there's people who make fake professions everywhere in any given church who aren't really saved. But I have no, you know, that they may have that just like they may have it at XYZ Baptist. But as far as what they supposedly believe about salvation, I have no reason to believe that this person is lost because he's going to Crosspoint. I have every reason to believe that he is compromised or low on discernment and needs to go to whycrosspoint.com. But not, I'm not going to follow him home like I would if he was a Mason. But you guys can pray that this person, the Nissan Rogue, goes to whycrosspoint.com. I think, I guess it would just be for my car and it would make people mad. I want to get stickers on the website that you can get, Y Crosspoint stickers, which is basically, you know, the two arrows going away. It's the opposite of their logo. I think I'd be the only person who would have one in my car in town. Even people who agree with me about Crosspoint are probably not going to share the website or put a bumper sticker on their car. I'm one of those people like, the emperor has no clothes. Like, shut up, kid. We all know he's naked. Don't say anything about it. But I would like to have one of those t-shirts. I may make t-shirts and stickers. We'll see, even if I'm the only one who has one. By the way, that's it for the Bible chapter review. Thanks for the question about Baptists and Anabaptists. Now let's move on to today's show topic, Christian media and the money men. And in this chapter, Megan Basham talks about Christian media sources like Christianity Today and how they get their money not mainly from subscriptions from churches as a newspaper, and I think they don't do a print Christianity Today anymore, but from groups that are grant-making leftist groups. And I want to say the opening vignette of the chapter involves the Trinity Forum, which was founded by an evangelical, Oz Guinness. And when Oz Guinness retired, other people took it over. And all of a sudden, it tried to be more mainstream towards the left, less evangelical, less conservative. And like, what's going on? How did this happen? And you look at who's funding it. Leftist groups with a bunch of money to give away. And then she gives the example of Christianity Today. So Christianity Today, I want to say, was founded in 1965 by none other than Billy Graham. So Christianity Today, the idea is like, this is the news for evangelical Christians. This is what evangelical Christians think. Billy Graham was a Democrat, by the way, in case anybody was wondering. But that meant something different in 1965, didn't it? So that publication has drifted leftward and leftward over the years. And Basham gives plenty of examples of the things that they've written about. And you know what? Over the years, you know who has as well? Pulpit and Pen, Protestia, Jordan Hall. Jordan Hall used to call it Christianity Astray. And that's really what it is. And Megan Basham uncovered statements from editors about how they want to be accepted and mentioned in the New York Times, that they want to impress the secular elites and be thought of as people that are, you know, in the industry or in the fold with them. You know, intellectuals making the news, like New York Times people. Like New York Times people, in my southern accent. Yeah, they want the approval of Jesus. They want the opinion of the New York Times. That's what I'd say if I was an IFB preacher. Listen to me, Christian. Do you want the approval of Barack Obama and the New York Times? Or do you want the approval of the Lord Jesus Christ? Amen. But seriously, that's what they want. She researched their editorial political donations. Now, by the way, apparently newspaper editors are not supposed to be out there giving political donations. They're supposed to, they can vote how they want, but ethically, according to the ethical standards of the journalism industry, newspaper editors are supposed to not give political contributions because they're in such a position of influence or power to move a narrative left or right to one political party or the other. Nevertheless, do you know which political party Christianity Today's editors give to? Like all of them who gave? Democrats. So why would people from a Christian newspaper be giving money to the party of abortion and homosexuality and perversion? Well, because they're middling, moderate, progressive, social justice Christians. That's why. And you know who they take money from? Progressive social justice outlets. And you can find out all about it in chapter 4 of Megan Basham's book. And you got to think, who reads Christianity Today? You probably don't. Pew sitters probably don't read it. Every once in a while they might read it. Christianity Today is usually something sort of like a trade journal. Like, I just came from my guild today. Do you guys know I was in a guild? It's the Georgia Society of CPAs. It's a guild of professionals. It's a trade association. Okay? We're not stonemasons. We're not bricklayers. We're not electricians. Nevertheless, it's a guild for professionals, professional CPAs. And we have a political action committee. And we try to do whatever's best for CPAs. And we have our little training sessions like we had today. Right. Hold on, I'm trying to get over. Maybe this cross person point will go to my neighborhood. A lot of people from Atlanta or who work in Atlanta commute to Cartersville. So there are guild or professional publications that are influential that you may never read. Like I was going to make the point that I get a magazine called Current Accounts. Y'all never, you know, you don't read it, but your CPA does. And I, quite frankly, barely any of us read Current Accounts. I get the Journal of the Evangelical Theological Society, which you don't get, but your pastor might, if he's nerdy like me. I bet my friend Stephen James is in the Evangelical Theological Society. I'm going to ask him when I park. You? And the trade journal that your pastor gets is Christianity Today. And then who influences you and your congregation? Your pastor. So you have all these churches buying subscriptions to Christianity Today. And then the pastors read it and they think this is Christianity Today. And then they disseminate those ideas to their congregation. That's how the leftist influencers work. They pump money in to the quote-unquote shepherds for sale. That's just another way of doing it. That's how the left is getting in, through religion, news service, and Christianity today. Even though you're not reading these things, you're being influenced by people who do. So let me shamelessly plug myself. Share this podcast with your Sunday school people, with the people who sit in the pew next to you. Please, with the people in the choir or praise team at your church, the Lord knows they need to hear it the most. Share it. Mention it. Talk about it on your social media. Say, I heard this, or what about this? Get people listening to things like this to influence the church people. Because I assure you, the leftist and billionaire Soros people are out there doing it. What'd the kids say in, what was that movie? It's a book. The Count of Monte Cristo. Do your worst, for I assure you I will do mine. They're doing your worst. You better do your worst too. Fight them. Share Protestia. Share Dissenter. Share this podcast. Share podcasts like it. Don't be bashful. Listen, church people like to talk about stuff like this. They love it. And I have time to tell my anecdote, but I'm going to save it for tomorrow. Listen, just do something about this leftist influence. Turn off Christianity. Click the X on Christianity Today. Try not to share that if you can. And talk to your pastor about it. Tell him to cancel your church's subscription to Christianity Today. Say, my tithe dollars ain't paying for that. Do it like God's tithe dollars aren't paying for that. He goes, that's not your tithe dollars, it's God's tithe dollars. I'm like, listen, it's God's before I tithe it, and it's God's after I tithe it. So how about this? God's tithe dollars are not paying from Christianity Today if they're coming from the share of money that God has for me, that I'm giving. Because God doesn't give it to you, I do. I write the check for God's money, and then you're supposed to use God's money. So I'm not giving you any more of God's money. Unless we cancel this leftist influence on our church. Because listen, I'm going to tell you something about giving money. All right, donating to Christian causes, being a cheerful giver. Turn right to stay on Red Top Mountain. Your church is not the only organization in the world who needs money to do things for God. There's a bunch of churches. And the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. We somehow don't seem to wrap our minds around this when we give. Whether you're giving out of your excess or giving sacrificially, it's God's already. So even in the Old Testament, when you sacrificed your lamb, and by the way, the livestock was worth a lot of money, you're sacrificing something over to God, like, this is my offering? Yeah, well, it was already, in a bigger sense, His. Everything is God's. Okay, when these people say, like, well, you know, I give it to the church and then it's just up to God, you can throw a $20 bill out the window and say, God, may it find a homeless person who's going to buy food with it instead of skull buster and drugs. Okay, you can do that if you want. God's sovereign over every $20 bill that everybody threw out the window. But guess what? You don't throw $20 bills out the window. You give it to your church, but you got to have an expectation that the stewardship committee or the budget people or the congregation is not wasting it on things like Christianity Today subscriptions. Your finance committee is not entitled to your money. God is. And God is going to hold you accountable for your stewardship. Don't throw money down a hole. There are plenty of ways to give money for the kingdom. And if your church is not using that money for kingdom advancement, then it's got a problem and you need to fix it. If they feel like they're just entitled to all your money no matter what, how's anything ever going to get fixed? What about prayer and coming together in one accord? That'd be great. Let me know when y'all do that. Until then, you got some bad actors out there. Don't give them your money. If they have any sense, they will heed your warnings God will give him sense through your prayers. You will come together as one accord, and you will work it out not to waste the money or not to be bad stewards. But if it doesn't happen, stop giving them the money. For more on that, you can buy my book, The Cooperative Program and the Road to Serfdom. I don't care about the money. I might make a quarter. I don't even know. It's not about the money. I want you to have the book. Be a good steward. Spend your money wisely, because listen, they are spending theirs intentionally. That's it for the Christian commute. Lord willing, I'll be back with you again Friday, which is tomorrow. I've forgot what the title of the next book chapter is, but I think we'll do that unless I think of something else I want to do. I can call an audible if I want to. It's my show. As always, God bless, and as always, remember, Christianity is not about getting saved. It's about being saved. Oh no. Where's my recording program? I'm in a red light trying to turn this off. Here it is. Bye.